and the National Humanities Medal from President Clinton. She also has 25 honorary doctorates. She's quite simply one of the most astounding poetic voices of our time. Would you please welcome to the stage, Rita Dove.
AWP turning 50. But, wow, it does seem unreal to be me and Rita Dove at the same time. So how did it come to this? I was asked to tell you a little about that journey, but to tell you that as soon as those squiggles on the page coalesced into words and sentences, I was hooked on books. And that as soon as I learned to hold a pencil, I began writing and never stopped. That would be nominally true, but it still doesn't mean that my deep love of reading and my passionate desire to write would have survived growing into adulthood, because so much in our society fights against it. Education is undervalued. The humanities and the arts are regarded with abuse, tolerance in the best of times, and in the worst of times, well, nowadays, once again, the brute forces are rearing their heads to spout insults at everybody who doesn't toe their narrow line, denigrating everything their small minds cannot grasp. When I was growing up in the 50s and 60s, the cards were also stacked in a terrifyingly similar way. But I was lucky to have as my first mentors parents who wisely let me read anything I could find, from comic books to Shakespeare. There were no right or wrong books. There was only good or bad writing. And my schooling at times underscored this. All along the way, as I made it through a world that often either didn't notice me, or if I was noticed, reacted by name calling, bullying, disdain. There were a few teachers who went beyond their job descriptions to nurture our curiosity. Miss Wendy, who took us outside so we could commune with nature while reading poetry, and of course we promptly scattered into the woods. But it was a joy. And Mr. Hicks, who showed us how to dig into literature we didn't understand at first glance. Or Miss Oshner, who unwrapped the sonorous cadences of Thomas Hardy's Return of the Native. In the community, there were the family storytellers and master braggarts who taught the power of words by living example through their vibrantly narrated tales. As a teenager, I was still shy and self-conscious, seeking solace in the usual hackneyed adolescent love poems, composing doo-wop songs with my older brother, performing radio plays that we checked out of the local branch library using the microphone that my father had rigged up. And those productions usually involved waterfalls, so we could hold the mic near the kitchen faucet for effect. Creativity abounded, yet I don't think that in my youth the idea of being a poet ever crossed my mind, because I had never seen nor heard a living poet. Then came college, and in my freshman year at Miami University of Ohio, it was really a muddled quest for meaning. I changed my major four or five times according to what my parents wanted me to be, before settling on English. I had no idea that creative writing was an academic discipline, that it could be taught and studied, until one fateful day, a man in an electric blue Italian suit burst into my advanced composition class to announce that our instructor was in the hospital and out of commission for the rest of the term, and henceforward we would aspire to that most advanced form of composition, writing short stories. That man was Milton White, and his fiction writing workshops were where I learned first to appreciate the poignant clarity born of craft and art that informs superior storytelling. And then the next quarter, I enrolled in a poetry workshop taught by Jim Reese. And after that, as my father would like to say, it was all over but the show. How lucky I was to have come of age in the early 70s during a time when creative writers had begun to liberate themselves from the institutional maneuverings of literary theorists in English departments beholden to the Modern Language Association. Taking cues from academic success stories in musical and visual arts, creative writing began to assert itself as its very own and very American boson discipline. And it took, though, visionaries to realize that this movement called for an independent organizational umbrella. Two visionaries, to be exact. Their names were R.V. Castle and George Garrett. They knew that strength comes from alliances and partnerships, and so in 1967, they drummed up 13 creative writing teachers from 13 institutions to found AWP. A few more years passed before, with support from the National Endowment for the Arts, the Associated Writing Programs was able to establish annual conferences, but the groundwork had been done. Only recently, while researching AWP's early years, did I discover how close I'd always been to this marvelous organization, which boasted a broad multicultural outlook from the very beginning. My aforementioned fiction teacher, Milton White, at Miami, not only brought my author, Modern, into the fold as early as 1972, but that year, he convinced me to attend a summer writing conference motivated by his desire to reinforce the students' own theories of what creative writing can do, and to help that student, upon graduation, pursue a career in the teaching profession, an edict which should become a goal of in my own life. The following year, in 1973, my poetry professor, Jim Reese, submitted a poem of mine without my knowing it to George Garrett's fledgling annual AWP anthology that we've heard about in intro. And that poem became my first national publication, and by extension, a strong, motivating force to continue this strange creative quest. And as an aside, I'd like to mention that serendipitously, 15 years later, when I joined the faculty of the University of Virginia, George Garrett's office was right across from mine. And it was like a circle kind of closing. I miss his genial energy and his spontaneous laughter, the likes of which no one can imitate. So wonderful. But this is a birthday celebration of sorts. And I have no intention to give you a treatise on AWP's half-century history, nor can this little speech encompass all the awesome achievements of this organization. What I'm attempting to describe is the support AWP has provided for writers like me over the years, and what I have tried to do to pay back some of that debt. I don't think I would have been a poet, or at least my road to poetry would have been much longer, had it not been for those writers in academia who banded together and gave us a solid professional footing. Exactly 30 years ago, that sounds a long time ago, exactly 30 years ago, 1986, 87, I served as president of AWP's board of directors, to which I had been elected at the San Diego conference in 1985. The conference was much smaller back then, a few hundred participants maybe. and few if any panels were concurrent. But the finances were a mess, and there was a yelling. The finances were a mess, and there was talk of shutting down the organization. I remember that my fellow board member, Reginald Gibbons, jumped to the rescue by tutoring the rest of us in the use of a calculator in order to make sense of our predicament. And the upshot of it was to retire our debt and pull us out of the financial morass we had somehow sunk into. We needed a new executive director who knew what he or she was actually doing. So that fall of 1986, we hired Liam Rector, whom I'd first met when he was literature officer at the National Endowment for the Arts, and I sat on the poetry grants panel there. And without knowing much about finances or executive director duties myself, it still had become clear to me that he was an excellent administrator, and the board concurred. It was Liam who saved AWP at that time, and it was Liam, soon to be joined by David Fenza, who knew the intricate organizational ins and outs and the right bureaucratic pathways to lead AWP into the glorious future that we've been reveling in this evening. We owe him immeasurable gratitude, and as the honorary chair of our 50th anniversary, I'd like to dedicate my contribution to this conference to the memory of Liam Rector. But I would also like to thank you. And I would also like to thank all of you here who have worked to make AWP the roaring success it is today. We're going to have fun. Every age needs its troubadours, and we are lucky to have a great one with us this evening. To say that Mary Chapin Carpenter is one of the finest singer-songwriters of country music or Americana is a given. But as you all know, the best artists defy genres. She writes and sings songs that matter. She is a maker of lyrical narratives. A five-time Grammy Award winner with 14 albums to her credit, the only recording artist to have won four consecutive Grammys for Best Female Country Vocal Performance, Mary Chapin Carpenter composes songs for grown-ups in timeless situations about how each of us must persist, remember, suffer change, reinvent oneself, and then reclaim joy, especially joy in the pleasure of a good song well sung. And last but not least, the self-recognition that comes from the depth of feeling in that heart. Her most recent album is The Things We Are Made Of. The title song's second verse begins with these timely lines. And I remember feeling I'm alive and in need of no saviors. If the past's another country, I'm at the border with my papers. Well, many of us know that border. Many of us are at that border now. She is right there with us, and we are right there with her. Please join me in welcoming Mary Chapin Carpenter.
And I'm just going to go.